Brothers and sisters, I missed you. It's good to be back. Holy Spirit's been kind of putting this message in my mind for quite a while, and it hasn't went away. So the more I got into it, and the more urgent I felt the Holy Spirit wanted me to get this out. I don't like to hype up my videos, but I believe this is probably one of the most important videos that I ever will do. So I pray that you stay till the end. I build a strong case, I believe, for you to be re-baptized. Re-water baptized. It's unfortunate, but we understand that the local church on the corner and the system that we came out of is, a lot of it is tainted goods. It's watered down gospel. And if it wasn't, then we would be moving in power, plain and simple, plain and simple. So, you know, if you bought poultry or fish from Walmart and then you watch your local news at night and it says, yeah, you know, Walmart has been identified as, you know, their poultry and fish are carrying E. coli or salmonella. Well, the first thing you do is go to your freezer or fridge and, do I need to throw this away? You know, was the goods that I bought, is it corrupted? And so I think a lot of us have understood that our churches have watered down the gospel and have corrupted a lot of it. But yet we don't take the next step, which is a lot harder step, in saying, okay, what do I believe about God that has been tainted, has been watered down, and is stopping me from being the man and woman of God that I need to be? And so I really want to encourage you to be rebaptized, water baptized, after I show you just how important it is. And salvation and baptism, you cannot separate them. You cannot separate them. And please do not shut me off, because I believe just like you did. Oh, what about the thief on the cross? You know, he wasn't baptized. You know, I understand all the arguments because I believed him. In fact, I believed him probably until about a week ago. But after what the Holy Spirit showed me, it's severely important that you understand what water baptism truly is, because that affects, did God act on your behalf when you were water baptized? Satan has removed things from the church that are clearly in the Bible. He has clearly done that. But other things like water baptism, he hasn't taken them out, but he watered them down. Satan has clearly taken away the importance of water baptism by saying, you know, it's an outward act of your faith. That's what water baptism is. It's an outward sign to your loved ones and your friends and family in the audience that, you know, it's for your confession of faith. And that's total garbage, utter garbage. Has nothing to do with that whatsoever. That phrase came from St. Augustine describing the sacraments. He says it's an outward sign of the inward grace, and it goes on. But, you know, Satan stole that and put it for baptism for some reason. You know how many times I've heard that growing up in the church? It's not biblical. It's not found in the Bible anywhere. I need you to understand, just because you did the act, because you went underwater and were water baptized, it doesn't mean that God moved on your behalf and gave you the full benefits of water baptism. Let me explain. If doing the outward work was all you needed to do, then the Pharisees and the Sadducees would have been Jesus Christ's best friend. He would have loved the Pharisees. But he was clear to them, you are whitewashed tombs. On the outside, you do things on the outside, but on the inside, you're dead man's bones. Just that, again, with the woman with the issue of blood, there were people touching Jesus. The act of touching Jesus was going on by multiple people. But yet one person who said in her heart, if I touch his hem, I will be healed. She believed and had faith in her action. So when her action was complete, she received according to her faith. Okay? Giving, prayer, fasting, all examples in a row of, if you do these things in front of men, you will be rewarded by men. That is your reward. You get the praises of men. But if you do it in secret, if you give, fast, pray in secret, the Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. So person A, who gives $1,000 to the poor, and person B gives $1,000 to the poor, both of them are out of $1,000. But person A does it, you know, gets his name in the paper, you know, he blows the horns and trumpets and gets his name, you know. He does it for men. That is his reward. Person B does it in secret, and the Father, God, acts on his behalf and rewards him. both men are out $1,000, but only one man has received the attention of God Almighty. Do you understand? So if you are water baptized, not understanding what it means, or just doing it because it's church tradition, or doing it because you want to be members of a church, or doing it because it's an outward sign of your faith, you do not get the attention of God, because your faith in the act is not according to truth. It's not according to what the Bible says it is. And praise be to God, water baptism is amazing, okay? So get rebaptized, get the fullness of the benefits. So again, just because you do the outward act, it doesn't mean that you get the benefits. It's faith in action. Okay? You have to believe in the truth and then do the action, and then you will receive the reward. Okay, another point. Baptism is a foundational doctrine. It's foundation, right? Just like salvation. And I believe salvation and baptism go hand in hand. If you believe and are baptized, you will be saved. Mark 16:16. If you believe and are baptized, you will be saved. Okay? Baptism is foundational. Meaning, if you build your foundation wrong, what does that do to the rest of the house? It skews the house. How many examples does the Bible have to give us to have us understand that our Christian walk is based on foundation, and then we build off of that? And we add to it. We add. That is the Christian walk. We have the example that if you want to become a Christian, you need to carry your cost and sit down and count the cost before you build the tower. Okay, that's an example of building on a foundation. Build your house on the rock, not on the sand. Another example, Jesus is the chief cornerstone. He is what you guide the whole thing off of. He is the first setting piece, and you guide the whole rest of it off. So if your foundation, which baptism would be, if that is off, then your whole Christian walk is skewed, okay? So this is good news. Another example of progression is 2 Peter chapter 1, which is extremely important chapter, a very important chapter. I'll probably do a whole nother video just on that chapter, but it's a progression. Strive to add to your faith ethical excellence. Add knowledge. Add this, okay? You know, you start out with faith, and then you're adding this, and then you're adding this. And it says, add to this, this, and then add to this, this. Okay, so that's another example that, you know, we're building off of something. So again, if the foundation is off, the rest of it's going to be off, okay? Another great thing about getting rebaptized and doing it right is Acts 2:38. Then Peter said unto them, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So if you've struggled, you don't feel like you received the gift of the Holy Ghost, then go back a step. Again, right? We build. You know, if your attic is messed up, well, go back a step to the walls. You know, it's all, and if the walls are messed up, go back to the foundation. Okay, it's all building on each other. So again, Acts 2:38, then Peter said unto them, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the Holy Ghost. So just how important it is, in Acts 2:41, it says 3,000 souls were baptized and believed that day. Okay, 3,000. So there's 120 dudes waiting for the Holy Ghost. They got it. They baptized 3,000 people. So does that, again, biblically sound like your local church where you get saved and they don't even talk about water baptism, maybe until later? Well, if you want to become a member, you know, you need to be water baptized. We'll go through the water baptism classes, you know, 4 weeks of classes, and then you get baptized. It's all garbage. It was right now. It was right now. Okay, we're going to get into that a little bit. That's the reason why this title is Get Rebaptized Now, because the timing of it went hand in hand with salvation. You believed, they got you baptized right away, all right? But I want to go back to Acts 2:38. Be baptized, everyone, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Remission of sins. And it's kind of beautiful about that word, because it means, has two meanings. The first one is release from bondage, but the second meaning is what this one means. Forgiveness or pardon of sins, letting them go as if they had never been committed. Amen. But the release from bondage is pretty interesting because 1 Corinthians 10, especially in verses 1 through 2, but 1 Corinthians 10 shows us that the Israelites were an example to us. Okay? Whatever they did, their journey is an example to us. And in verses 1 and 2, it says that the Israelites were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Okay? So when they went through the Red Sea, that was their example of our water baptism today. Okay? So what happened during the Israelites' Red Sea? And the reason why I believe this is so important, and in fact this video I'm going to use in my deliverance series, is because this is a form of deliverance. When the Israelites went through the Red Sea, right, God waited till they're on the other side, and God opened up the sea, but when the Israelites are on the other side, God smashed the Egyptians. Okay, so what did he do in essence? The people who were bound in bondage were trying to come after them again to re-enslave them, okay? God, because through water baptism, the process of water baptism, God destroyed the ability for the Israelites to be re-enslaved, okay? That's why the crux of this message starts in Romans 3 and ends in Romans 8. I need you to read Romans 3 to Romans 8, if you want to understand the completeness of this message, okay? Romans 4 is about, and Romans 3, I think Romans 3, 21, and Romans 4 is all about faith. You're saved through faith, just like what we're saying here. If you don't believe the fullness of what baptism means, then you're not going to receive the fullness of what baptism means. It's plain and simple, plain and simple. Jesus Christ would even say to some people, what do you want me to do for you? What do you want me to do for you? And they would say, I believe you can open my eyes. I want you to heal me of my leprosy. And it's like, according to your faith, it shall be done. Well, if you get water baptized, according to your faith, that this is just an outward sign of your belief, well, according to your faith, it was just an outward sign of your belief. It's meaningless, absolutely meaningless. So, chapter 4, Romans 4, Abraham saved by faith. Chapter 5, you know, the Bible talks about, you know, if it repeats itself, then it's really like emphasizing you really need to pay attention. It really bothers me that Christians still think that we're under the curse of Adam. Because in Romans 5, it's about five times that Romans 5 says, well, if Adam, a man, brought in this tremendous curse, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, how much more so counteracts that curse and destroys that curse. But yet Christians are still thinking we're under the curse. Okay, another point. Number five is justification by faith. And then number six is the crux. Okay, number six is the crux. It says, when you are baptized into Jesus Christ, you are buried with him. Okay, you are buried with him. And when you come up out of the water, you are a new creation. All right? That is the reason why you get the Holy Spirit, is because you're a new creation. Holy Spirit comes down on you. Father's pleased. Whole nine yards, okay? Chapter 7 goes into more of why it's a remission of sins, because it goes into the example that when you're married, you are bound to your husband. But if your husband dies or if your wife dies, you are no longer bound by law to that person. So when, you know, the law is perfect, but the law shows you that you sin. If there's no law, there's no sin. Because it says, I didn't know that I lusted until there was a law saying, do not envy. And then now I know that I lust. So if there's no law, there's no sin. But it's saying, don't blame the law is perfect. So what did Jesus do? He died for us, but he needs to kill us as well. And that's what water baptism is. You actually kill yourself. You kill your old self through water baptism. So does the law apply to dead people? No, it doesn't. The law does not apply to dead people. That's why there's the remission of sins. No more law, no more sin. Okay? But it does continue on and say, now that you're a new creation, don't go back and, you know, do evil. Right? Just like the Israelites were freed from bondage. They were freed from the Egyptians after 430 years. But yet they still chose to murmur against God. They still chose idolatry. They still chose, freely chose these things. Okay? But this is a form of deliverance. Actually, the Holy Spirit actually going through this message with me, there's multiple things that the Israelites did that is a direct parallel to us, including deliverance. I thought deliverance was the baptism, you know, killing the Egyptians off, but that's just kind of a form of deliverance. You basically kill your old self, your old nature, and it doesn't come back, okay? According to the Word of God, it's done. You are a new creation. You are dead. You are identified with Jesus Christ's death, and you are now identified with Him. That's why belief and salvation and Jesus Christ and baptism is, you cannot separate them. You cannot separate them. Because you identify with Jesus Christ's death. That's how you are saved. The remission of sins is because you die through water baptism. I really hope you guys are getting this. I really hope you guys are getting this. Look at the Ethiopian eunuch. And the angel of the Lord spoke unto Philip, saying, arise and go toward the south and unto the way that goeth down to Jerusalem, unto Gaza, which is the desert. Okay? So they're in the desert, right? It's not a palace. I just want to keep that in mind. All right? They're not in a king's palace. Just keep that in mind. They're in the desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem for to worship. Okay? I don't know about you, but this is probably the longest title of any man in the Bible that I know of. Okay? Apart from Jesus. Okay? Ethiopian eunuch, great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasure. Okay? I just want to paint a picture here. They're in the desert. What do you think this guy's wearing? You think he's wearing a bathing suit? No, he's probably in his kingly robes. He had a great authority in charge of the treasure, right? He probably had richly, pretty nice stuff on. Granted? Okay. Verse 28, was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran over to him, heard that he's reading Isaiah. He needed somebody to talk to him. So verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came into a certain water in the desert. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, okay, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe. He confessed with his mouth, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Okay? It's all the same, guys. And when they had come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. Okay, so what drives an Ethiopian eunuch of great authority wearing his kingly robes to undress and get dipped into desert water? What drives a person to do that? The truth of what water baptism is, that's what drives a man to do that. Okay? Now, if the Philip said, oh yeah, this is just an outward sign of your belief, well then, they're in the middle of the desert, so who's it assigned to? Each other? Again, another hole through that demonic lie, all right? The truth will set you free. So if this is an outward sign of a faith, of a belief, then he would have waited until he was back at his kingly palace where the nice, you know, clean waters and did like a little nice celebration party thing like we do nowadays. Okay? That's garbage. It's utter garbage. So again, when you read Acts and stuff like that, you know, granted the Holy Spirit would fall on people and then they would get water baptized, or they'd get water baptized and then the Holy Spirit would come down. So if you speak in tongues, and you're saying, oh, well, I got the gift of the Holy Spirit, so that means automatically that I don't need to be water baptized. Well, that's false, because in Acts, I'll put the verse down here. But it also says that the Holy Spirit fell on them before they're even water baptized. Okay, so it doesn't let you off the hook. I shouldn't have to let you off the hook anyways. If you didn't believe water baptism was this important, okay, was like you are literally identifying with Jesus Christ's death and his resurrection. I mean, this is you solidifying this belief in your life, then I don't need to make excuses for you, you know? You know, the whole thief on the cross. Well, are you on a cross right now, number one? Are you on a cross right now? So that thief on the cross thing doesn't apply to you, period. Number two, in the whole beatings and Jesus Christ crucifixion, not once did they punch out his eyes. Okay, so Jesus Christ had eyes. He could clearly see the dude was on the cross and could not be baptized. So I think that maybe factored into his decision, don't you think? I can't get mad upset because I believe the same thing. I'm just upset at the devil and that I was deceived as well. There's also another fallacy that I've heard about water baptism, and I don't want to be rebaptized because I don't want to spit on God because I'm calling into question what he did for me on my first baptism. Again, that's just not scriptural, guys. In 2 Peter 1:10 it says, "Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence," which means to strive, "strive to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, ye shall never fall." Again, 2 Peter chapter 1 is amazing. Break down the words. But I mean, here, where else did you ever know that the Bible guarantees that ye shall never fall? Ye shall never fall if you do this stuff. 2 Peter 1, guys, awesome. But he's saying, strive to make your calling and your election sure. So, to me, if you're going to make it sure, you got to check and recheck, and if you get new information, apply it. So again, that's a fallacy. Don't buy into that. Oh, don't go backwards. Don't check on your foundation because you know you're just spitting in God's face. That's demonic. Please get rebaptized. You know, there's nothing that says about who needs to baptize you. In fact, if it's in front of God, then I think that's all that matters. If you have the faith of what it means, go fill up your bathtub, get your wife, whoever, and have them dunk you, okay? Stay underneath the water. Understand that right now I am dying to my old self. I am dying to my old self. Therefore, the law doesn't apply to me because I'm a dead person. And just like the Israelites, right now, God is killing my old self. God is killing the way back. God is, you know, the waters came back, so he stopped the way from going back to Egypt, and he also killed the people from them enslaving them again and bringing them back to Egypt. All that stuff is happening while you're underneath that water. Once you come out, you're a new creation now, and now you shall receive the Holy Spirit. Pretty amazing, huh? Pretty foundational stuff. If you didn't believe that when you first got baptized, get rebaptized. Now, God bless you. I love you. Have a good one. Get wet.